going to be standing like this.
Yeah, no, I'll sit down. I'll sit down. Sit down. No. For the end. Nah, not working.
Shen.
Oh, I don't think this is working.
Inshallah, we'll finish today the first hadith in this great book. This hadith that we are still talking about, which is the hadith al-amalu bil-niyyat, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Innama al-amalu bil-niyyat, wa innama likulli imrin ma nawa, fa ma kanat hijratuhu ila Allahi wa rasulih, fa hijratuhu ila Allahi wa rasulih, wa ma kanat hijratuhu ila dunya yusrifuha aw imra'atin yunkihuha." And we previously said that the niyyah that we talked about is two
but no, I can't.
One
is going to trip. I don't know where the stand gone.
Establishing of the aqidah, which is that all the deeds that will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to have a niyyah. And this niyyah has to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and has to be according to the sunnah, and it has to be also away from the shirk and riya.
I don't know if we explain this in detail.
So inshallah today we'll be focusing on the jurisdiction and the fiqh dimension of the niyyah. In this fasl, in this little chapter, Hafiz ibn Rajab al-Hanbali talks about the niyyah from a fiqh point of view, and then talks about the difference between the opinion of the different ulama and the different matters of fiqh. So he says that the niyyah, with the jurisdiction means that the fuqaha means, it differentiates the ibadah from the ibadah, differentiates the act of worship from the normal act outside of worship, and differentiate between the different types of ibadah. So if someone woke up in the morning and said, I'm going to do a diet. This diet is called intermittent fasting. And I won't be eating or drinking. Let's say intermittent fasting, you can't drink. But let's say that this person said, I won't drink or eat until Maghrib time. But he did not intend this for Siyam. From a worshipping point of view, he intended to do so from a diet. He wanted to lose weight. So this does not get counted as the siyam for the sake of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because here he is doing a normal act outside of ibadah. He intended a normal act outside of ibadah. And if a person, on the other hand, if a person intends siyam for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is counted as siyam. And siyam is different. There is siyam al-fard, like Ramadan, and there is siyam al-nafl, like, you know, Mondays and Thursdays, the 3 days of each month, and then of each month, siyam yawm arafah, and so forth. And the 6 of Shawwal, and so forth. So these types of siyam, these are sunnah, nafl siyam, which is different from siyam Ramadan. And again, he also says that there are different salawat. There's 5 daily prayer, and there's also the nafil prayer, like Sunnah al-Fajr, Sunnah al-Dhuhr, and so forth. And there's also zakat. And there's zakat is the obligation. And there's sadaqah, which is charity, which is non-obligatory, but it's a nafil. So the different types of ibadah and the different types of ranks of ibadah, fard and nafl, and each one has to have a specific name. He says, وَلَا يَتَمَيَّزَ كُلُّ هَذَا كُلُّهُ إِلَّا بِالنِّيَّةِ, and you cannot differentiate all of this except having an intention. And then he says, so he establishes this foundation that every single act has to have a niyyah specific for this part of it. Now he goes into the difference in the opinion between the ulama. Because some ulama, they, for example, say for a niyyah, for the established prayer, for the five daily prayers, some ulama say that you have to have a specific niyyah when you're about to pray dhuhr or asr. But some ulama say, no, you don't have to have a specific niyyah for asr or maghrib. You just have to have a niyyah for that you are doing the fard salah, the obligation salah. You don't have to have a specific niyyah. Obviously, we are talking about the niyyah here in the heart. We're not talking about someone saying something. This is very important to do. The niyyah is in the heart. You do not say, I am about to, oh, I intend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I am praying, this is wrong, this is bid'ah, this is not in Islam. Okay? So you have to, the niyyah is in the heart. So someone might say, and it's one of the narration from Imam Ahmad, that the Salatul Fard, that you don't have to have a specific niyyah for each Salat Fard, which meaning that you just have a niyyah for Fard in general, whether you pray Asr, however, the majority of the ulama, they say that you have to have a specific niyyah for each salah. So Salatul Dhuhr, you have to have an intention that you are praying Dhuhr. You have to have an intention to pray Asr and so on. وكذلك ذهب طائفة من العلماء أن الصيام على أن صيام رمضان لا يحتاج إلى نية معينة أيضا. The صيام of Ramadan, some ulama, they say, some scholars, they say that Siyam Ramadan, you don't have a specific niyyah for Siyam Ramadan, because when it comes to Ramadan, there is only one type of Siyam that you can do in this month. So you just have the intention of fasting, but it's without a doubt, it's going to be for Ramadan. And وقد حكي عن بعضهم أن صيام رمضان لا يحتاج إلى نية بالكلية لتعيينه بنفسه, as we said. فهو كرد الوداع. This is a very, very minority opinion. The majority opinion that you still have to have a niyyah for Ramadan. That you have to have a niyyah for Ramadan. Is this clear or should I repeat it again? وحكي عن الأوزاعي أن الزكاة كذلك, وتأول بعضهم قوله على أنه أراد أن تجزئه بنية الصدقة المتفق الحج. وكذلك قال أبو حنيفة لو تصدق بالنصاب كله من غير نية أجزأته عن الزكاة. This is a technical point. So when it comes to zakat, some also ulama say, when it comes to zakat, so let's say a situation that you are giving a charity, okay, and your intention is that this is a charity, but you end up paying the limit of zakat without knowing. Let's say that you're supposed to pay zakat $5,000. But then the time of zakat comes and you don't intend zakat, you intend sadaqah. And you give out $5,000, so that is all, the limit of zakat. Some ulama say that, and this is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa, that this will be counted as zakat, even though that you don't intend. Even though that you don't intend zakat, because you have already given the limit of zakat and you have the intention of sadaqah, the zakat comes and you get the niyyah of zakat. But again, this is not the majority opinion. The majority opinion that you have to have a specific niyyah for zakat and you have a specific niyyah for zakat. This is important. And then so we spoke about salah and we spoke about siyam and zakat. We spoke about hajj.
Yes.
So the niyyah, so for example, the niyyah for salah comes by you leaving your house to come to the masjid. Similarly, the niyyah for siyam is tanaqid when you, for example, eat suhoor. Does it answer your question? So you don't have to say the niyyah. You don't have to say, I intend to fast the month of Ramadan. You don't have to say it. No. No. There is no ibadah that you have to say except for Allah. At the end of this chapter, we'll talk about a small exception for Hajj, which is called Tasmiyah Mu'niyah. We'll talk about the difference.
That's quite a big thing because a lot of people make the intention to fast on this day, at this time.
It's all in the heart because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you think about it, the easiest way to do the niyyah is to have the intention. There is no narration from the Prophet or the Sahaba that you have to say the niyyah. And some people make it very difficult for them, they have to say the niyyah for every single day of Ramadan. And by the way, I just want to make it fixed clear. I'm reading here from the book and I'm not making any interpretation of it. I'm just reading the Hafl, the Rajab words. But yeah, the sunnah is, from the Prophet is that you don't say the niyyah. You just hold have it in your heart. When you have suhoor, this is becomes the niyyah for the next day. But if you intend that you're going to fast the whole month of Ramadan, then it's done.
عن روي عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه سمع رجلا يلبي بالحج عن رجل فقال له حججت عن نفسك قال لا قال هذه عن نفسك ثم حج عن الرجل.
So this hadith is narrated by Imam Abu Dawud and Ibn Majah, but this hadith actually authentically does not go all the way to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is the hadith from the words of Ibn Abbas. So the correct opinion that this is not a hadith, but it's the same of Ibn Abbas. This is in the science of hadith called mawquf. It's called mawquf. Mawquf means it stops at the Sahabi. Does not have an authenticity from the Sahabi to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when there is the hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is authentically narrated from the Sahabi and it's proven, that this is a hadith proven that the Sahabi heard this from the Prophet, this is called marfu'. Marfu' means it is definitely connected all the way to the Prophet. Mawquf means it stops at the Sahabi, meaning that there is no authenticity in this specific chain of narration that it gets all the way to the Prophet. Again, this is all the technicality of the science of hadith. So the hadith says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we said that this does not go all the way to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard a man saying that he says, "Labbaik Allahumma Hajj," that I want to do Hajj. But he said, "I want to do Hajj, not for me, for another person. I want to do a Hajj for so and so person." The Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Did you do a Hajj for yourself already? Did you already do your obligatory Hajj already?" The man said, "No." And the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "You first go do your Hajj obligation, and then you can do the Hajj on another person." Okay.
ولكنه صحيح عن ابن عباس وغيره.
So the Hafiz al-Rajab says that this hadith is not actually authenticated from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but it is authenticated from the saying of Ibn Abbas and others.
وأخذ بذلك الشافعي وأحمد في المشهور عنه.
So Imam al-Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad, they say in their opinion that a person cannot do Hajj for another person unless this person already performs the obligatory Hajj. This is the opinion of Imam Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad.
وغيرهما في أن حجة الإسلام تسقط بنية الحج المتقدم سواء نوى التطوع أو غيره.
So even they go one step further, Imam Shafi'i and Ahmad. Even though that this person
may intend, may this person may intend to do a hajj on another person, it is counted for him, not for that other person. Let's say a person wants to hajj for his mother, but he hasn't performed hajj for himself first. If he goes to hajj, even though his intention is for his mother, to do the hajj for his mother, the hajj is counted for himself. This is the opinion of Imam Shafi'i. The opinion of Imam Malik and Imam Abu Hanifa, no, is that a person can do a hajj for another person even though that this person haven't done hajj for themselves first. Is this clear, the technicality here? And also, another tafsila here that it's important when it comes to the niyyah. Imam Ibn Rajab says, وَمِمَّا يَدْخُلُ فِي هَذَا الْبَابِ أَنَّ رَجُلًا فِي عَهْدِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ قَدْ وَضَعَ صَدَقَتَهُ عَنْ رَجُلٍ فَقَالَ فَجَاءَ وَلَدُ صَاحِبِ الصَّدَقَةِ فَأَخَذَهَا مِمَّنْ هِيَ عِنْدُهُ فَعَلِمَ بِذَلِكَ أَبُوهُ فَصَمَّهُ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقَالَ مَا أَرَكَ مَا إِيَّاكَ أَرَكَ فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَصَمَّ لَكَ مَا نَوَيْتَ وَقَالَ لِلْآخِرِ لَكَ مَا أَخَذْتَ رَوَاهُ الْبُخَارِي. So this hadith is narrated in Bukhari. This is a great example. So a man, he gives his sadaqah or zakah, and we'll talk about the important difference between the sadaqah and the zakah in this particular matter. A person gives his zakah, the zakah or sadaqah, to another person, or gives it to the masjid. And then the son of this man, without knowing that his dad gave this sadaqah, and without the dad knowing that his son is in need for this sadaqah, that the son came to the masjid and took from the sadaqah, or took the whole sadaqah, or took the whole zakat. So the father knew afterwards that his son took the zakat, but he said to him, so he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he was angry with his son. He said, I didn't mean that this money will go to you when I gave this zakat or sadaqah. This wasn't for you. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to this man, your intention will be counted and your zakah will be counted, and for the son, you get to keep what you took because you are in need. Okay, is this clear? So a man gave sadaqah for the masjid and he wanted, you know, people from the Muslims to take this sadaqah, but he didn't intend it for himself and his son is in need. So this son came and took the money. And then the man got angry because I didn't mean to when I gave the sadaqah. So at the end of the day, the Prophet ﷺ said that you have your niyyah, which is sadaqah, and you have the niyyah, that you have the money, you can keep it. وَقَدْ أَخَذَ الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدْ بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثُ وَعَمَلَ بِهُ مَحْسُوسُ عِنْهُ وَإِنْ كَانَ أَكْثَرَ أَصْحَابُهُمْ عَلَى خِلَافِهِ. Okay, فإن الرجل إنما يمنع من دفع الصدقة إلى ولده خشية أن يكون محاباة. This is an important تفصيل when it comes to zakat. The zakat, so charity you can give to anyone. Zakat, anyone in need. But zakat has specific ways that you can only give zakat to. We all know that, you know, for example, you cannot give zakat as the vast majority of the ulama, like 99%. They say you cannot give your zakat to build a masjid. Your zakat, the 99% of the ulama, they say you cannot do that. It's only 1% of the recent ulama. Some of the recent ulama say you can do that. But even that with specific conditions, like the masjid has to be attached to it, like a madrasa for teaching Quran and so forth. This is not the topic of our talk. But the zakat has specific ways. You can give sadaqah to build a masjid, but from the conditions of the zakat is that you cannot give your zakat to someone who depends on you from your dependence. So you cannot give your zakat for your son, for your dependence that you already give money for. You cannot give zakat to those people, to your dependents. You can give sadaqah to them and it's counted, but when it comes to zakat, you cannot give it to your dependents. فإذا وصلت إلى ولده من غير أن يشعر كانت المحاباة منتفية. So if in this situation, even the zakat, if it gets to someone of their dependence without them knowing, then it will be accepted. وهو من أهل استحقاق الصدقات في نفس الأمر. ولهذا لو دفع صدقته إلى من يظنه فقيرا وكان غنيا في نفس الأمر أجزأته على الصحيح. Now if you pay your zakat or sadaqa to someone that you think they're rich, sorry, you think they're poor, but turns out that this person is pretending to be poor, but they're actually rich and they don't deserve sadaqah. What happens to your sadaqah or zakat? It is counted. It is counted as zakat and sadaqah because you assess your zakat and sadaqah based on what you see. You know, you have beggars in the streets that they might be very, very rich. They don't need any money. And they, you know, they might go home and they, you know, they open their Mercedes or they have their, you know, mansion. But they continue to beg people for money. And you don't know. So they don't deserve the zakat or salaqah. But because you don't know and you take it from face value, then your zakat will be counted as zakat or salaqah. Okay? وأما الطهارة فالخلاف في اشتراط النية لها مشروع، وهو يرجع إلى أن الطهارة للصلاة هل هي عبادة مستقلة أم شرط من شروط الصلاة كإزالة النجاسة وستر العورة. Now coming to talk about طهارة which is وضوء. Making وضوء. Making وضوء there is difference in the opinions of the علماء. Mainly إمام مالك إمام الشافعي إمام أحمد بن حنبل. They say that طهارة is an independent worship. Is an independent worship. Imam Abu Hanifa, his opinion is that the tahara or the wudu is not independent. It is part of the salah. It is part of the conditions of salah, like removing the dirt, mujasa, and like satr al awra, which is protecting and covering your awra when you are doing salah. Because covering the awra and removing the najasa is from the conditions of the salah. So the Imam Abu Hanifa, they have the tahara, the wudu, as a precondition of salah. And it's attached to the salah, so it's not a separate ibadah. And why this is important, we'll say why. The Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, they say no, wudu is an independent worship. Independent. ومن اشترط لها النية جعلها عبادة مستقلة. That's why. Because Imam Malik, Imam الشافعي, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, they have the condition that the tahara, the wudu, must have niyyah. Must have niyyah. So, if you, for example, and we mentioned this before, if you have wudu or take a shower for the sake of, let's say that you feel really hot and you've been working in your garden for a long time and you want to take a shower or make wudu just to feel cold, or not to feel cold, but you know, to remove the feeling of hotness and remove the humidity feeling. But you don't have the intention that this is for wudu, for salah, that this wudu, or that, sorry, You're not doing this for the sake of wudu. You're just doing this for the sake of removing that feeling of hotness. Okay, like for example, going to the beach and jumping in the water just for the sake of you want to swim. But if you have the intention of ghusl or wudu with the intention that you're doing this for the sake of tahara, for the sake of eventually doing salah, okay, then you must have this intention for this wudu to be accepted and for this wudu to be a condition of salah. Imam Abu Hanifa says that you don't have to have this intention for tahara, for wudu. And you can, for example, if you did already ghusl for this, even for the sake of just feeling fresh, that this you can use it to pray. And this is an important tafsir, this is an important detail. ومن اشترط لها أن يجعلها عبادة مستقلة فإن كانت عبادة في نفسها لم تصح بدون نية. So if the طهارة, the طهارة, the wudu is an independent worship, then it is not correct without any intention. Now you can make wudu, you have the intention to make wudu and keep it for different salawat. You don't have to have an intention for wudu for every specific salah. You can just have an intention of I'm making wudu to pray. And this becomes the niyyah of wudu. So you can pray duhur and asr, and if you're a champion and able to not go to the bathroom until maghrib, you can do maghrib and isha. Now some people do. Okay? You can do one wudu with many salawat. And you can do salatul fardi and salatul nafl. Okay? With wudu. But the, and this is the, and he says here, وهذا قول جمهور العلماء. This is the saying of the majority of scholars, as we said, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad. They say that you can have, that you must have a niyyah when it comes to wudu, but when it comes to Imam Abu Hanifa, the intention in wudu is not necessary. ويدل على صحة ذلك. So now he talks about the evidence that the opinion that the wudu is a separate version that needs a specific niyyah is the more correct opinion. ويدل على ذلك تكافر النصوص الصحيحة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن الوضوء يكفر الذنوب والخطايا وأن من توضأ كما أمر كانت كفارة للذنوب. That the opinion of that the wudu is a specific worship that needs a specific niyyah, the evidence for it, that this opinion is correct, that there are so many hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that wudu expiates the sins and removes the sins. And whoever who makes wudu, it would be an expiation for his sins. You know the hadith of the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever makes wudu, you know, his sins will go out of his body, even from underneath his nails. Okay? And whoever makes wudu and washes his face, washes his eyes and face, that the sins will go out of his eyes and so on. And whoever makes wudu and says, "Inshallah, la ilaha illallah, wa la sharika lah," Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open all the gates of Jannah for him. So the hadith, when it comes to the benefits and the expiation of the sins by wudu are plenty, and as such, the wudu becomes a separate worship. والوضوء الخالي عن النية لا يكفر شيئا من الذنوب بالاتفاق. And wudu without having that intention does not expiate the sins by the opinion of all the ulama. So he deduces then that the opinion of the ulama that say an intention in wudu is essential is the correct opinion. And then the last bit of this, where he says, وَلِهَذَا لَمْ يَرِدُ شَيْءٍ وَلِهَذَا لَمْ يَرِدُ شَيْءٍ مِنْ بَقِيَةِ شَرَائِطِ صَلَاةِ أَذَالَةِ النَّجَاسَةِ وَصَرْفِ الْعَوْرَةِ مَا وَرَضُهُ فِي الْوُضُوءِ مِنَ التَّوَائِبِ. And so if you remove the removal of the dirt and the protecting of your awra when you pray, there is nothing in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that equals the benefits that was mentioned when it comes to wudu. So then, that also strengthens the opinion that wudu is a separate event. And the last point of this is وَلَوْ شَرَّكَ بَيَانِيَةِ الْوُضُوءِ وَبَيْنَ قَصْدِ التَّبَرُّدِ أَوْ إِزَالَةِ النَّجَاسَةِ أَوْ الْوَسَخِ أَجْزَأَهُ فِي الْمَنْصُوصِ عَنِ الشَّافِعِي وَهُوَ قَوْلِي أَكْثَرُ أَصْحَابِ أَحْمَدٍ لأن هذا القصد ليس بمحرم ولا مكروه ولهذا لو قصد مع رفع الحدث تعليم الوضوء لم يضره كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقصد احيانا بصلاه تعليمها للناس كذلك الحج قال خذوا عني مناسككم. Okay. So if you intend to make wudu, you have the intention to make wudu, that this intention that this wudu is for salah, but also that you make the intention that your wudu is to remove the dirt. Let's say that you again work in the garden and you're very dirty, and you have the intention of also removing the dirt and being fresh, and also the intention of wudu. So you can combine all of these niyas in one, and this is the opinion of Imam al-Shafi'i and Imam the majority of the companions of Imam Ahmad, the scholars of Imam Ahmad, the students of Imam Ahmad. لأن هذا قصدي ليس بالمحرم ولا المكروه And also that you can, if you are teaching someone wudu, if you're teaching someone wudu and you have the intention of wudu, that teaching someone wudu also, you can combine the niyyah. So you can teach someone wudu, that combines the niyyah of teaching wudu, the intention of wudu for the sake of salah, the intention of removing the dirt and so forth. So you can combine many intentions when you are coming, when you're making wudu. So you're showing people how to make wudu, that in itself, you can also have the intention that you can use this wudu for salah. وَمِمَّا تَدْخُلُ فِيهِ وَمِمَّا تَدْخُلُ النِّيَّةُ فِيهِ مِنْ أَبْوَابِ الْعِلْمِ. This is very important when it comes especially to things like taking an oath or طلاق, divorce. مَسَأَلُ الْأَيْمَانِ فَلَغْوِ الْأَيْمَانِ لَا كَفَّارَةَ فِيهِ وَهُوَ جَرَى عَلَى اللِّسَانِ مِنْ غَيْرِ قَصْدٍ قَوْلُهُ لَا وَاللَّهِ بَلَى وَاللَّهِ فِي أَثْنَاءِ الْكِلَامِ كما قال الله تعالى في سورة البقرة لا يؤخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم ولكن يؤخذكم بما كسبت قلوبكم. Okay. So when it comes to saying an oath by Allah, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not hold you accountable for the vows that you have in your oath unintentionally, the unintentional vows that you have in your oath. Okay, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds you accountable to the oath that you have intention, that you the oath that you intentionally intend. So if you say to some to one of your sons or one of your children, by Allah, if you go to this house, if you go to if you get out of my house and go to so and so house, you shall not come to my house ever. Let's say this is intention. Obviously, no one should ever do such an oath. Okay. Similarly for your wife and so forth. But if you say this with the intention that 100% you have this intention, that this oath becomes an intentional oath, and you cannot go back on your oath without having a kafara. But if you say in your talk, wallahi, I didn't, it's very easy to demonstrate it in Arabic, let's just say, I went there wallahi, and I didn't pick up something, whatever. You're saying something, but you're saying the oath in a way that it's not really intentional, and you don't have an intention that this oath is basically what you mean. Or for example, someone is telling you about a person that he's not coming to the masjid, and you say, wallahi, I know that this person is traveling, but it turns out that this person was not traveling. Similarly, you don't have to expiate your kafara for this oath because you didn't know. Okay, so this is the difference between an intentional oath and an oath that you just say for the sake of normal saying. Similarly, when it comes to talaq, divorce. Okay, if someone was to say to his wife, "If you go out of my house, you'll be divorced," but you're saying this not for the sake of your intention is not divorce. Your intention is threatening. The majority of the ulama say that this divorce does not fall. This divorce does not happen. Because you are not doing it for the sake of threatening. Your intention is, from face value, that you are threatening. Again, no one should have the divorce in their words. It's an if that someone uses the divorce in a way that is like this. Okay, because it's not good for your family. It's not good for the cohesion between your wife. But if someone had the intention that really, if she goes out of your house, that she is divorced, she'll be divorced. So he's saying to her, "Anti talaq, idha kharajti min al-bayt." You are talaq, you are divorced. If you go out of the house and you have the intention that she'll be 100% talaq, then she'll be divorced. And if a person says this out of threatening, then it all comes back to his intention. Okay. The other thing is saying the divorce When you say the divorce, if you say it three times, you know, in Islam, if you divorce your wife three times, then your wife can never go back to you unless she marries someone else. Real marriage, not just for a day or two so that they can divorce them and then he can go back to you. Real marriage. So if you, and this is from the Rahmah of Islam. Rahmah of Islam gives you three opportunities, okay? But if someone was to say to his wife, you are divorced three times, what happens? Let's say in one sitting, you say to your wife, you are divorced three times. أنتِ طالق ثلاثة. If someone was to say to his wife, أنتِ طالق ثلاثة, she becomes divorced from him three times. But the Imam Ahmad, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, Imam Malik, Imam Abu Hanifa, they all have the opinion that your wife becomes ba'ina, that she cannot go back to you unless she marries another person. Three times, if you do divorce your wife three times, whether it's in one sitting or over a period of time. She cannot come back to you unless she marries someone else. Real marriage. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, he says that if a person says to his wife, you are divorced three times, that this is counted as one. But the Imam Ahmad Ibn Taymiyyah, his opinion is the very, very, very minority opinion, and the correct opinion is with the four Imams. That a person divorces his wife three times, she becomes divorced 100%. Okay? But if someone was to say to his wife, anti talik, 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 and talib, and his niyyah is affirming only one talqa, you know, sometimes you repeat words to affirm what you're saying. Do not ever come back to the house. Do not ever come back to the house. Do not ever come back to the house. You don't mean it that they don't come back to the house three times. You mean it that they don't come back to the house, period. And this is an assurance. So if someone was to say to his wife, anti talib, 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 with the intention of assurance, not for the intention of numbering, and then this his wife becomes talaq for him one time. Okay? But he has to use the same word, talaq, talaq, talaq. He cannot say anti talaq wa thalathan, because assurance comes by repeating, not by a numbering. Okay, this is a little important detail. But the summary is, when you make an oath, or especially when it comes to oath, you have to have the intention that this oath is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this author's intention for it to be counted as this. So the niyyah then is extremely important when it comes to things like at-talaq and things like taking. Inshallah, we'll end with this tafsir at the end. But the reason Imam Ibn Rajab mentions all this to justify what Imam Shafi'i said, that he said in the beginning of the explanation of the hadith, that this hadith enters in more than 70 chapters of fiqh. We understand now, you know, these ulama, they don't say things out of the blue, nothing. They say for specific reasons. Because the niyyah enters in 70 chapters of fiqh, that's why Imam Shafi'i said this, that this hadith is so important. So at the end, he says, this is Imam Rajab, والنية قلب القلب ولا يجب التلفظ بما في القلب في شيء من العبادات. That the niyyah is in the heart, and we should not say the niyyah in any of the worship. وخرج بعض أصحاب الشافعي له قولا باشتراط التلفظ بالنية للصلاة وغلطه المحققون منه. And some of the students of the Shafi'i, they said that Imam al-Shafi'i said that you can say the niyyah in salah, but this opinion, remember Ibn Hafiz, Ibn Rajab, he says, this opinion is invalid and it has not been authenticated that Imam al-Shafi'i said this. ولا يعلم في هذه المسائل نقل خاص عن السلف ولا عن الأئمة إلا في الحج وحده. That no one says that the niyyah can be said, whether it's from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the Sahaba or the Imams, except when it comes to Hajj. فإن مجاهدا قال إذا أراد الحج يسمي ما يهمه. So for example, that you are about to do Hajj or Umrah, and you're about to do the ihram, you were to wear the ihram, and عقد عليك الإحرام. You say لبيك اللهم حج or لبيك اللهم عمرة or لبيك اللهم حج وعمرة. You say you here, you say لبيك اللهم حج وعمرة or لبيك اللهم حج or لبيك اللهم عمرة. You don't say the saying of oh Allah, I intend to make Hajj or Umrah. So there's a little difference. You say لبيك اللهم حج لبيك اللهم عمرة because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said this. كما فإن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يذكر نسكه في تلبيته فيقول لبيك عمرة لبيك عمرة وحجا. This hadith in the Sahih by Imam Muslim. Okay. وإنما كلامنا في أنه يقول عند إرادة عقد الإحرام اللهم إني أريد الحج أو العمرة. So this is not what we say. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to say لبيك اللهم عمرة وحجا, but he didn't say that I intend to do Hajj and Umrah. So this is the difference. لبيك اللهم حج وعمرة is different from actually saying اللهم إني أريد الحج أو العمرة. وصح عن ابن عمر أنه سمع رجلا عند إحرامه يقول اللهم إني أريد الحج أو العمرة فقال له أتعلم الناس أو ليس الله يعلم ما في نفسك. And it is also narrated Abdullah ibn Umar, he said that he heard a man saying I want to perform Hajj and Umrah, or saying the intention I intend to perform Hajj and Umrah. He said to him, are you teaching people, are you letting people know that you're about to do Hajj and Umrah? He said no. Then he said to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. But the tafsir here, the difference is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said لبيك عمرة وحجا. So you say the exact words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لبيك عمرة لبيك حجا or لبيك عمرة وحجا, so that you are in the sunnah, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is only in Hajj and Umrah. Jazakumullah khairan. So inshallah we'll end with this. Does anyone have any questions about what we said? Because it's very confusing.